Which side is my better side, left or last side? Jeez.
All right, scene one, take two.
Hello, my name is Angela Spinella. I am the practice manager of the pediatric subspecialties here at Valley Medical Group.
I'm Antonio Quiroz. I am a pediatric gastroenterologist. I'm also a clinical professor at Icahn School of Medicine at Mount Sinai Hospital, and I'm the associate chair of Women's and Children's Services at Valley Medical Group at Valley Hospital.
So today we have Dr. Quiroz here, who is one of our pediatric gastroenterologists. So we're going to talk about some of the signs to look out for your, you know, your children and at home. So a lot of the calls that we get in our office are about, you know, parents asking, what's the difference between a tummy ache and a really serious illness? So how would you kind of help them determine one way or the other?
More often than not, in younger kids, lack of growth, lack of weight gain can be subtle signs of there being something wrong. Obviously, fevers of unexplained origin, blood in the stool, those are usually easy signs. And those quite often are the ones that lead the parent to seek medical care. But those can be very late findings, and obviously, you know, you want to catch things earlier. Looking for some of these other signs can be very helpful. Older kids, obviously, they are quite often good about voicing their complaints. But again, same thing. Sometimes the fact that they're not growing adequately, lack of sexual maturation, delay in their development, poor weight gain, can be subtle signs that there's something wrong with the child that merits further attention, even if they're not having any other clinical symptoms of a digestive disease.
Gotcha. So you want to tell parents to make sure to question. So if someone's like a little picky eater and they're really young, say, you know, how come you're not eating that? And see if they can point to where it hurts or things like that, right?
And there's a specific issue, a specific food item that they're avoiding. There might be something more to that. And there's ways of being able to investigate this further without being too invasive. Mm-hmm. But you know, we're happy to see them in clinic to help sort that out if needed.
What are the symptoms that patients should look out for, or parents should look out for, and can you like elaborate on those symptoms?
The things that you're looking for are abdominal pain that disrupts play, abdominal pain that disrupts sleep, lack of growth, lack of sexual maturation, lack of weight gain, mm-hmm. And obviously more clear signs of a problem might be recurring fevers that you can explain, and obviously blood in the stool, which quite often when that happens, usually the parents rush to seek medical attention because it's a very distressing finding. Sometimes having the parent question the child and ask, by the way, when you go to the bathroom, are you seeing any blood in your stool? Or, you know what, next time you go to the toilet, why don't you, before you flush, call me. I want to take a look.
Got you. So you mentioned endoscopies. Can you kind of elaborate more on those type of procedures, you know, what parents should look for, things like that?
One of the things that we're capable of doing, this is a procedure that we perform both at Valley Hospital and at Mount Sinai Hospital, is things like, for example, enteroscopy, which is actually an ability to be able to go deep into the small intestine with a special endoscope. So you can examine the whole intestine from the mouth all the way to the colon with one endoscopy. We're able to do that, and that's good for management of recurrent bleeding, management of polyps or tumors in the small intestine. The other thing that we do quite often is something called endoscopic ultrasound, which is basically an endoscope ultrasound machine that's attached to an endoscope, and we're able to interrogate and sample tumors, lesions in the pancreas, in the liver, in the retroperitoneal area next to the kidneys, in the pelvic floor. And then on top of that, you have something called endoscopic retrograde cholangiopancreatography, which is a long way of saying, basically, with an endoscope, being able to get into the liver and into the pancreas to perform advanced procedures in that area. That is important for patients who have chronic liver disease, chronic pancreatic disease, and these are procedures that we perform regularly at Sinai as well. The endoscopy procedure, in general, are minimally invasive. Most procedures are performed in an ambulatory setting, so the patients go home the same day. And reality is that the main risk associated with the procedure is the anesthesia itself. Most of the procedures are very short-lived, and the risk of any complications are very, very low. So in general, it's a very safe procedure. We perform them regularly, so it's not something that merits an enormous amount of concern, but obviously there are risks associated with a procedure, and we usually discuss it with families and patients way before the procedure to try to educate them about what to expect.
Sounds good. So I want to thank Dr. Quiroz for coming with us today and kind of talking more about pediatric gastroenterology. Is there anything else you want to add before we end?
In general, I want to thank for the opportunity to be able to talk to people today. In general, for the patients that are existing patients at VMG Pediatrics, I want to thank you for your faith and allowing us to serve and care for your children. For patients who are new patients to our practice, I want to welcome them.
One of the great things about having this comprehensive care where we have everyone in one location is that if you have an issue with gastroenterology and Dr. Quiroz feels that you need to be looked at by an endocrinologist, he can go right next door to his colleagues. So we hope to see you guys soon, and we look forward to serving and caring for you.
Thank you.